Good evening, folks, and welcome to a very special episode of the Third Impact Anime Podcast. As some of you may know, we were recently at Animazement in Raleigh, North Carolina. We were their featured panelists for this year, and we could not thank them enough for having us out to do an absurd amount of panel content for them this year, something like 24 hours over the course of the whole weekend, which it may sound exhausting, but it was really fun, actually. Additionally, at the event, we were able to interview two folks that I think you guys will be particularly excited to hear from. The first being the subject of this particular episode, which is our interview with Robert Woodhead, the founder and CEO of AnimEigo, one of the oldest anime licensing companies in North America, if not the oldest. This episode will be our interview with him, where we discuss how AnimEigo came to be, the different titles that they've released throughout the years, and how Robert thinks the anime fandom has changed throughout time. And while Bill and I were talking to Robert, Sully had the chance to interview the voice of Frieza in Dragon Ball Z, the iconic Linda Young, and we are very excited to share that interview with you all very soon as well. Of course, we want to send a huge shout out to all of the Animazement staff for putting on such an awesome event. The panel staff in particular were just outstanding. They were doing a great job the whole weekend. They were very helpful, very attentive. We really, really appreciate their work. And we really hope to come back next year. That would be awesome. And if you like the panels that we do or the podcasts that we make, please consider supporting us by either just sharing our content with your friends or supporting us on either Ko-fi or on our brand new Patreon, which we just set up probably about a week ago. We don't have much by the way of perks just yet, but if you have any suggestions for us, we are all ears and we are eager to hear your ideas about what we might be able to do as perks at some point. You can find links to all of our social media content, including our crowdfunding pages, via our Twitter page, which is twitter.com/ti_anime or just @ti_anime. And you can find the links to all of the social media junk that we have on our link tree, which is linktr.ee/thirdimpactanime or on our website at thirdimpactanime.com. Again, thank you so very much to Robert Woodhead for being on the show. We really do appreciate it. And we also cannot wait to put out our interview with Linda Young as well. So please enjoy this episode, and we'll see you guys in the next one. Folks, we are here at Animazement in Raleigh, North Carolina, and we're talking to Mr. Robert Woodhead, the CEO of AnimEigo. How are you doing today, sir?
Fine, thank you.
Good. Well, thank you so much for taking the time to sit down and speak to us a little bit and to sort of tell our listeners about the work that you do and the work that you have done for many decades at this point. A lot of the episodes that we do on the podcast are about older anime. It's something that we care a lot about. We appreciate the seasonal grind, but we understand that there's a lot of fun and interest to be had when you return to the old classics. So it's thanks to companies like Discotech and like yourself that continue to make vintage anime relevant in the modern era. So we really appreciate you for that. So thank you.
Thank you.
So could you tell us a little bit about like how AnimEigo came to be?
AnimEigo actually started as a joke. I was writing computer games, and one of the people I was writing the games with was a huge anime fan. This was back in the day when there was no commercially available anime. It was all like third generation VHS copies and no subtitles. And basically one guy in the club who knew Japanese was live translating. I'd just gotten a video board for the Macintosh 2 that allowed me to put graphics on top of video, and I was playing with it, And he saw me doing this, and he said, well, could you use that to subtitle? And I said, yeah, you know, pixels are pixels. No big deal. And he said, well, could we subtitle some of my anime so that I can show it at the fan club meetings? And I said, yeah, I guess so. But, you know, I'm always going to Japan on business. Why don't I go get some licenses and we'll sell it? And after we stopped laughing at how awfully stupid this idea was, it couldn't possibly ever work. In no way was ever going to be a viable business. It's like, who would buy this stuff? We decided, what the hell? We got nothing to lose. It's not going to cost really any money to try it. And so that's how the company got started.
So roundabouts, like, what year do you think that was?
89.
So there had been anime in America before then. So how easy was it for you to, I guess, like, break in, I guess? Like, what was it like to, you said, go over to Japan and get licenses? Like, what did that look like?
Initially, it was quite difficult. And in fact, our first license came from the U.S. subsidiary of a Japanese company.
Okay.
A sort of a trading company. But once we'd done, I'd gotten the title out, the first title we did was called Madox 01.
Yeah.
Once we'd done that, at least we had something to show that, you know, we weren't just a bunch of, like, crazy fanboys. I got a call from Toshio Okada,
yeah,
one of the founders of Gainax, and he said, come over and do a computer game convention for me as a guest, and I will get you interviews and meetings at all the anime companies. And so I went and did that, and he not only got me interviews, but he provided me with an interpreter. And so I spent the entire week running around Tokyo with this woman as my interpreter, and after all the business was done, I asked her out on a date. And the long story is, we're still together.
Oh, great. That's awesome.
So that's how I met my wife. And so the response from the Japanese was cautious but positive, but nobody actually wanted to do a deal.
Right.
And I was complaining to Okada that, you know, everybody seems to be very nice, but nobody actually wants to, you know, sign anything.
They didn't want to commit.
Right. And he said something that was either very wise or some of the best bullshit of all time when he told me that everybody wanted to be the second person to do business with me.
Oh, I see.
Well, as it turned out, a few months later, one of the companies did decide to try me out, mm-hmm, and that was Writing Bean. Mm-hmm. And after that, the floodgates opened, and now, you know, since I'd done business with a Japanese company in the Japanese way, now sort of I had somebody vouching for me, and then it became relatively easy to get licenses.
Okay. So I guess how did you then get Writing Bean out to the American fans?
We translated it. We actually got on the internet before it was the internet, when it was Usenet, and found some people in rec.arts.anime, the original Usenet newsgroup, who were interested in giving it a try, and did translations, and I wrote the first version of our subtitling software, and went into a video studio, and literally we had one big machine with one tape, and another big machine with another tape, the record tape, and my computer in between, and literally we had to press play, press record.
Ooh,
and
wow.
Then I had a mouse button, and I had to, like, tap the mouse at just the right time to start the synchronization.
Wow.
And then there was a point a few seconds later where I could pop up a title and release it, so that I could tell if it was absolutely perfectly synced.
Right.
And if it wasn't, then we'd have to like rewind everything and start it again. It took about 5 or 6 attempts to get it right, and then we edited out that subtitle at the end.
Right.
That's how we made our first master tape.
Okay. Yeah, because that was going to be my question. Like, in such a digital era, like, I mean, I'm a young person. I have no idea how you did subtitling in the analog era, but it was like you would run tape through a computer, and that's how you would do it?
Well, that's how we actually did the final copy.
Okay.
Certainly the computers weren't, and the hard drives were not big enough to store digital video at the time.
Right.
So what we eventually did figured out how to do was... we would go and get the master tape dubbed to VHS, or Super VHS, actually. And we would split the audio channels, where one audio channel would be the actual program audio.
Right.
And the other audio channel would be time code audio. Where time code wasn't digital back then, it was analog. It was all done with audio signals. It sounded like a modem sound, basically.
Okay.
And I had a little tiny box that could read the audio and send it out over a serial port so the computer could read it. And then we would run that tape through the computer and make a copy of it, and instead of subtitling it, I would put up like a little bar chart of the audio volume.
Okay.
So once you had that, you could then go back and you had like the time code superimposed, was displayed by the little box, and you had this kind of bar chart, and you had the actual video, and so you would play it on your VHS tape, and when somebody started talking, you'd hit pause, and then you could just rewind the jog shuttle back to where you saw the volume go doop.
Oh, I see.
On the bar chart.
Okay.
And then you'd know, okay, that's the time code for that piece of dialogue,
right.
And that's how you would sync it.
Okay, cool. That seems very resourceful. Was that sort of the standard practice?
That's how we figured out how to do it.
Uh-huh.
Other people basically did similar things.
Right.
I actually wrote custom software to try and automate it a little bit, but
right.
Mostly it was a lot of spinning around. It wasn't like, nowadays you just go into Final Cut, you just like zip
right.
back and forth. Oh, there's the waveform.
Yeah.
Well, we took that waveform and we actually had it on the video.
That's amazing.
Because we couldn't store the video.
Right, right. Wow, that's amazing.
But, the tools have changed a little bit, but the process
right.
of just staring at the damn screen for hours on end
right.
is pretty much the same.
Right, right. I guess jumping from Writing Bean, what was next after that?
Bubblegum.
Okay. And that was a huge hit, wasn't it?
That was the one where people started to say, yeah, there's a real business here.
Right, right. Because that one's sort of a staple. Like, people, when they look up vintage anime, Bubblegum Crisis is kind of a poster child for that in some ways, for that sort of aesthetic and that style.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I guess after Bubblegum Crisis?
Oh my goodness. Then it was just like tons of stuff.
Tons of stuff.
I mean... too much to remember,
right.
And some things I'd like to forget.
Right. I know you did a lot of like live action movies too.
That came later.
Okay.
That came when in the early 2000s, when the license costs were getting so high that it just wasn't it was just not economic for us anymore to do anime.
Right.
So we kind of switched into live action.
Right.
And then there was a big anime bust.
Right.
A lot of companies went out of business, and we're going like, we're doing the whole bullet time thing because we made the right choice about going into the live action.
Right.
Actually, when it comes to Japanese live action cinema, I think most anime fans, it seems to be, they either know Akira Kurosawa movies or they know live action adaptation of anime that they like. Was there a title you think that AnimEigo released that you think more anime fans should see, or that you personally really enjoyed?
Oh, there's tons of them. We did Lone Wolf and Cub.
Oh, yeah.
That was actually the first thing we did. And the story about that was that we were at Toho, and we'd just done, you know, a meeting, and we licensed some anime, and I asked them, oh, offhand, you got anything else you think we might be interested in? And there was a little conversation, and then the junior guy went off, and he came back a few minutes later with some brochures, and literally was brushing the dust off the brochures.
Wow.
And it was all, like, samurai films. And, like, the third one from the top was Loma from Cub, and even I had heard of Loma from Cub. And I go, like, oh, maybe we can do something with this. And so we tried that, and it turned out to work pretty well, so we did a lot of other live action. The Zatoichi films. There's a great film called The Blind Menace, which was the film that Shintaro Katsu did before Zatoichi, in which he plays a blind character, but a, like, total evil, it's like scenery chewing evil bad guy. It's just wonderful.
That sounds like fun.
Yeah, it is. Yeah. Sleepy Eyes of Death series, which is like oh, like 12 film series. There's a lot of really great stuff. You know, AnimEigo has always not so much been about doing things that we think are going to make us a ton of money.
Right.
It's more about doing things that we like think we'd enjoy working on that.
Right,
and
right.
If it makes money, then we get to do more cool stuff.
Right. So you mentioned Lone Wolf and Cub, and Kazuo Koike passed away maybe like 2 or 3 weeks ago. Did you ever get a chance to meet him?
No, I didn't.
No. So you mentioned you know, doing things for fun and not necessarily that would make you a lot of money. So pre your Kickstarter days, like, what did make you the most money?
It was a lot of things. I mean, most of our stuff made... There weren't too many things that didn't make money.
Right.
There's some things that did better than others. There's some things where we should have made more money than we did, but we ended up spending too much money on the production. Probably the best example of that is Macross, where we spent just an insane amount of money restoring that series. And it was supposed to come out, but 9/11 happened right before it came out.
Oh, man.
That it was a big economic disruption based on that. So that was a little unlucky, but you know, we made money on it, and we're perfectly happy with how it turned out.
Right.
In general, the things that I don't think are going to get make much money tend to do pretty well, and the things that we got to do this because we're going to make money end up tanking. So,
oh, I see.
It shows you how good of a businessman I am.
We mentioned this quickly before the podcast started, but we're kind of living in a resurgence era of Urusei Yatsura. So we've got the original mangas back out in print from Viz. Discotech put out Beautiful Dreamer last year. But you originally had Urusei Yatsura TV that still no one has. So do you have any interesting insights on working with Urusei Yatsura as a franchise?
Well, I love the series. It's one of those few series that actually got better the longer it ran. I mean, in the later seasons are actually better than the earlier seasons. I enjoyed it, but we did the entire run of UI eventually, which ended up being like over 60 DVDs.
That's a lot.
That's a lot.
That's a lot of shelf
DVDs
space.
DVDs just for the TV series, not including the movies and the OVAs.
Did you do that on tape as well?
Yeah. I don't remember if we got it all out. I don't think we got it all out on tape before we switched over. I think we got up to about 20 or 25 tapes.
Okay.
And about 20 laser discs.
Okay.
Before we shifted over to DVD. I mean, it literally took us about, I think, over 10 years.
Wow.
To do that series.
I know, okay, go ahead, Bill.
Oh, one other series that I have a personal affection for is the Lupin the Third franchise. And I know that AnimEigo at the time released the Fuma Conspiracy, and you all guys also did The Mystery of Mamo. So I was wondering if you could also talk about your experience with the Lupin the Third franchise, because I know at the time of the copyright issues, you couldn't actually call him Lupin the Third.
Yeah, well, it's one of those things where we probably could have, but the original producers said, hey, can you not use Lupin because of the French estates getting all crazy about it? So we just said, well, here's how you spell it in Japanese, Rupan, so yeah, that's what we'll do. Actually, we released Fuma and The Legend of the Gold of Babylon.
Oh, I'm sorry.
It's okay. Those are the sort of things, when the licensor asks you to do something, asks you for a favor, you just say yes and you don't worry about it too much. The fans know what it is.
Right.
So I wasn't too worried about it.
Right, right. So at one point, if I recall correctly, correct me if I'm wrong, but you guys were working with CPM to put out Beautiful Dreamer?
The story about that was that the rights in Urusei Yatsura were split between two companies. Toho had Beautiful Dreamer. I think it was Toho.
Yeah,
Toho had Beautiful Dreamer.
Godzilla stuff in that movie and stuff.
Right. And another company was the licensing agent for everything else.
Okay.
So I was living in Japan at the time, and my strategy was I was going to go to the other company and get everything else, and then I tootled my way over to Toho and pick up Beautiful Dreamer. Mm-hmm. At the exact same time, John O'Donnell of CPM was at Toho, and his brilliant master plan was he was going to lock up Beautiful Dreamer and then head over to the other company and lock up everything else. And we literally executed the contracts like within a couple of days of each other, and then tootled across town and going like, oh shit.
Oh my gosh. That's funny.
You gotta be kidding me.
Yeah.
So what actually happened was that we translated and subtitled Beautiful Dreamer for him so that the styles would all match.
Yeah.
And when we released a movie box set, we actually made the box set one tape bigger so that you could slot in the CPM version.
That's
funny. It had a little spacer in it so you could get the CPM thing and slot it into the box.
That's cool. So you mentioned Studio Gainax earlier, and one of your notable releases is, of course, Otaku no Video, which both of us really love. We think it's a great picture into sort of the timeless nature of otaku, because there are a lot of things in that film that were very true then that can still in some ways be true now, so it's a really fun little OVA. So do you have any stories about working with the Gainax guys, other than, of course, meeting your wife, which is kind of a big deal?
Yeah. Well, we still work with them. I mean, we talk to the Gainax people all the time. They're friends of ours, and they're very helpful. They know everybody, of course. So when we're trying to dig up materials for one of the titles we're doing, they're often a great resource. Mr. Sato of Gainax has done commentary on several of our discs.
Okay.
You know, he's very knowledgeable. And they're just like really chill people. So we're always happy to work with them.
Gotcha.
And of course, but we've known them forever.
Right. That's cool. That's awesome. So I guess let's move into what you're doing now. Like, your first Kickstarter was Bubblegum Crisis.
Right.
So where did the idea come from for you to do that for crowdfunding stuff, which is something prior you hadn't done?
Well, actually, Macross was sort of, I like to call it paleo crowdfunding.
Okay.
Because we literally did that. We did that and Kimigoro and Jirode, where we didn't collect the money in advance, but we said, like, we can get like 5,000 people or whatever who say they will buy it,
right,
promise to buy it, we will go out and do
okay.
it. And, you know, people signed up and pretty much kept their word. I still have emails in my archive for people like saying like, I can't I know I promised to buy it, but I lost my job.
Oh, and I'm going, oh. I hate that.
Yes. I said, like, don't worry about it. We'll make an extra one. We'll hold it for you.
That's kind of you.
But the Kickstarters have never been about funding the project. They've been about getting, about as a distribution system.
Right.
Getting about marketing, getting the word out, and also involving the fans in the actual production.
Right.
So we actually let fans volunteer to work on some of the projects. Some of them have actually started working for us professionally. They were just like so good that we said, we cannot let you volunteer. We have to pay you.
Oh, nice.
And several of them have transitioned into having professional positions. They're doing things in the industry now,
right,
where, you know, basically working on one of these crowdfunding projects was kind of like their resume item, which is always good, although I kind of feel guilty about it now because, you know, I like inflicted the anime business on them.
I'm sure it can be grueling at sometimes.
Yeah, I jokingly refer to this business as the sausage factory because it's like once you know how the sausage is made, you never want to eat it.
Right.
And that can kind of ruin you a little bit in that you see all the flaws, you see all the shortcuts. When you have to, and when you have to watch something like 10 times, even if you like it, you know, doing that final proofreading check is like, it's like blood is dripping out of your eyeballs.
Yeah, I bet. I bet watching the same stuff over and over for QC and all that stuff can get really exhausting.
Yeah, it's really annoying because, like, I just got a QC report from one of our testers on Gunsmith Cats.
Yeah.
And it was like, we got it down to the point where it's really a little nitty gritty. Like, stuff like I put hyphens in the wrong places or I've been inconsistent with my hyphenation. And I go like,
Right. So, I guess you've done, Bubblegum Crisis, Otaku No Video, Writing Bean, and now you're working on Gunsmith Cats. So you keep doing it, even though it's the Sausage Factory. So what keeps you coming back to keep doing these every time?
Well, each project has its interesting things about it. Either the people who were the original creators that we get to interact with, or we try something new. On the Gunsmith Cats projects, we worked out, based on fan feedback, a bunch of extra goodies that we could make, like keychains and rubber straps.
I'm excited to get mine.
Yeah. I actually have some of the samples that, that I'm showing at our panel this afternoon. Mm-hmm. So there's always that. We're always trying out new things. I do enjoy the creative process of the dialogue editing when I'm doing the subtitles and the layouts, because I do all that stuff myself.
Okay.
And, you know, voicing the characters from the translation, making sure that it's right, the research and stuff like that. So, I wouldn't do it if I didn't enjoy it. I mean, I don't need to do this. I'm of an age now that if I wanted to retire, I really could.
Right.
But I still enjoy it, and I enjoy the reactions that it gets. So I'm, you know, happy to do it as long as I can find interesting projects.
Right, right.
When you first started doing Kickstarter, I imagine going to Japanese companies, they were a bit kerfuddled or a little hesitant doing the Kickstarters for distribution. So was it hard at first to convince them, like, Kickstarter is a good route for us to go to get these wonderful classics out to the public?
Yeah, it was in many ways just like what it was back in the beginning. Everybody wanted to be the second person to do it with me. And it actually took a couple years before we managed to get the Bubblegum Crisis project going, getting everybody lined up. But once Bubblegum Crisis done and was a success, then the other projects became much, much simpler to get done. And you know, our next one's going to be Megazone 23. We announced that about a month ago, I think, that we...
Is that all three parts?
All three parts, all the dubs, because there are multiple dubs, we're getting those. Mr. Mickey Moto is going to do new artwork for us.
Oh, awesome.
And we got other people lined up to do commentaries, and so it's going to be an interesting project.
Yeah. I just watched the first one for the first time like 2 weeks ago. It's really fun.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah. It's a good, like, very poppy, enjoyable little sci-fi thing.
Yeah, and it is the first, well, second, really, OVA.
Yeah.
First one is Dalos.
Yeah.
Which, by the way, is on Amazon Prime.
Nice.
No, it's awful.
I've never seen it. I just know.
Trust me.
I think it was like an early Mamoru Oshii thing or something. I don't know.
Go watch it on Amazon Prime. But be warned, once seen, it cannot be unseen.
Oh, no. Sounds ominous.
What major lessons have you learned from working on Kickstarter? Because I've heard from... just about Kickstarter disasters of people overpromising and having a deal with the physical goods. Now, how that can be a big anchor chain to a Kickstarter project.
Well, there are always problems. Every single one of our Kickstarters has delivered late, not too late, but late, and each for a completely different reason.
Wow.
I like to think of it as a new and interesting reason. So like right now, we're running a little bit late on this one because Mr. Sonoda started working on his Bean Bandit project.
Right.
And that turned out to be a huge amount more work than he thought. And so he's late on delivering some artwork to us. So we're kind of hanging fire waiting for the artwork.
Did that have its premiere recently?
Yeah, just last week at Anime Central.
Okay.
So cross fingers, we'll get the artwork really soon. My attitude is the smart way to do these things is under promise and over deliver.
I see.
And so when we hit a delay, I'm always going to use that time to try and make the product a little bit better.
Right.
So that that delay means something. It's not like I'm just going to sit on my thumbs
right. And
wait. We're continually QCing, finding little tiny tweaks, maybe add an Easter egg. We do a lot of personalization on the discs so that the backers all have their names on the discs.
Right.
Stuff like that. And also you got to be good at your logistics. I wrote custom software to handle the logistics of packing up all of the products and getting them out. And actually, I give that software away. It's real nerdware. I mean, you really have to go in and tweak it to make it do what you want.
Right.
But it will do absolutely everything a Kickstarter project needs to do.
Right. So I guess you've been based out of Wilmington for the entirety of AnimEigo's existence?
Not the entirety.
Okay.
We started out in Ithaca, New York, which is where I was working.
Okay.
Then I moved to Japan for 6 years.
Okay.
And my mother ran the U.S. end of the business from upstate New York.
Okay.
And while I was in Japan, she moved down to Wilmington.
Ah.
So the company moved with her. And so then I moved back to Wilmington when my wife and I moved back to the U.S.
Okay.
So we've been there ever since.
Okay.
It's a total coincidence. She moved to Wilmington for her own personal reasons, and it just happened that Wilmington was also a movie production center, which had a lot of, you know, good production people and voice actors and all that sort of stuff. So when we were doing a bunch of dubbing, we had all those resources available. It was a complete accident.
Okay, cool. So I guess this might be kind of a difficult question, but it's hard for us to like zero in on like what the history of like the anime fandom and specifically North Carolina was like. So is there anything that you think sets our state apart from other regions of the country?
Yeah.
Might be kind of a hard question.
Better barbecue maybe?
I guess. I mean,
I would agree with you 110% on that one.
Yeah, I mean, it's good barbecue, but yeah, I don't know. It always I get curious about that stuff, and maybe there's nothing, but I don't know.
Well, how do you think fandom has changed in general?
That might be a better question.
That's a tough question. I see a lot more cosplay now than you used to. In fact, I have this sort of theory that Japanese anime cosplay is what has caused Halloween to become a much more adult holiday.
Right.
In that cosplay at anime conventions and then later at like Comic Cons made dressing up for adults kind of socially acceptable.
Right.
And then that kind of bled over to Halloween because, like, when I was a kid, Halloween was 100% kids.
Right.
And like 13 years old tops. And now, of course, you know, there's adult Halloween parties and all that sort of stuff. And I have a feeling that's sort of a cultural bleed over from Japan. And now, of course, it's all gone back because now they're celebrating Halloween in Japan.
Right. This shirt is from Tokyo Disneyland.
Exactly. Yeah. It's like, when I'm actually in Japan almost every year at the end of October. And so, like, I see all the Japanese Halloween stuff, and it's like, oh, it's so strange.
Yeah, it's pretty wild.
I think I have two questions.
Okay.
AnimEigo was around during the big bubble that was around during the mid-2000s.
Yes.
And it's crazy just the amount of money companies were spending on different titles. Was there any kind of funny or interesting stories from that bubble period that really sticks out to you?
Well, there were several times when I was interested in a title and I was told how much somebody else had bid for it. And I just looked at the people across the table and said, if they've offered you that much money, take it. Take it and insist on cash in advance.
You don't have to tell us like a title or exact figures, but what was the usual ballpark that you would hear?
Oh, there have been several bubbles. I mean...
Do you think we're entering into one now?
Actually, one just popped.
Oh.
A couple years back. Oh. Yeah, I don't want to get into specifics about the numbers, except that it was like about 5 times more than I thought.
Wow.
I mean, if somebody can pay that much money and make money at it, then they're just much better businessmen than I am.
Right.
And not that I was ever claiming I was a great businessman. You know, but I knew how much I thought I could pay and still make money, and some of the amounts were just insane.
Gotcha.
And I would also ask, in recent years, I would, with companies like you and with Discotech, more classic titles have become more available and have gained more of a fandom, whereas maybe in the earlier days of anime fandom, we kind of had a specific perception of we want anime to be a certain way or we only want the new stuff. Why do you think classic titles have kind of gotten this resurgence in recent years?
Well, I think part of it is that older fans who grew up with the classic titles, they have a great deal of nostalgia for them. And so, especially when we can release them on Blu-ray, they really want to get the best possible quality version of this title that meant so much to them. And that's why we're really big on doing everything we can possibly do to make this sort of a reference collection.
Right.
You know, like an art, so that, you know, 20 years from now, this will still be like the best version of it that it ever was.
Right. I'm sure you get this comparison a lot, but like the Criterion version.
Yeah. You know, just gathering all the materials we possibly can that are still available.
Right.
And so it's part of it's that, and part of it's as new fans become, you know, really knowledgeable, they want to look back to the roots, because so many of the tropes that are in the stuff they currently love can be traced back through the creator, through the links to the shows and creators.
Right.
back to the early days, and you see like you know, this particular explosion style,
right,
dates back. There's a great example of that in Gunsmith Cats, in the commentary. This is something I'd never heard of. In one of the commentary tracks, the Japanese commentators, there was an explosion on the film, and they literally said, "Oh, that's a Masuo explosion."
Oh.
Done by this guy named Masuo, who was like famous for this particular style of like how the explosion would come out and dissipate.
Right.
Unfortunately, he passed away recently. So they were saying, "Oh, he's passed away. We'll never get another Masuo explosion."
Right.
And so I watched the show from like 1995, you know, and I'm going, "God damn, I've seen that explosion in so many later stuff."
Right.
Because he not only worked and did his signature, literally his signature explosions,
right,
in later shows, but other animators have, you know, been influenced by his style. So you see these kind of explosions mutating through the years.
Right, right.
And I just thought that was just a wonderful little tidbit that if we hadn't done this show and the backers hadn't backed it enough to do this commentary,
right,
because it was a stretch goal,
uh-huh,
I would have never learned that, and the backers would never know that little thing. And now, when they go back and watch something from 10 years after that, from the mid-2000s, they'll see that, they'll be looking for the explosions.
Right.
And just the little tiny things like that, these your links in a chain.
Right.
Okay. I think are really help improve your awareness and your appreciation of the artistry and the hard work that goes into it.
Right.
And also the thought, you know, where they've done something that, unless you know the historical background, it'll just like swing straight over your head. You'll never notice it. It'll look nice, but you'll never really appreciate it.
Right, right. So I guess sort of in closing, and you can answer for anime, Japanese media, or otherwise, but what art are you into right now personally? Like books or movies or whatever, something that you're really enjoying right now?
I always like to say that I like anime, but I'm not a fan.
Right.
Partially because I'm in the business, but you know, partially because, you know, I know that if I became a fan, it would destroy my life.
Right.
I have that kind of personality, so I have to kind of hold myself at arm's length. I enjoy genre TV, I enjoy genre movies, historical dramas, science fiction. You know, I have a wide range of interests. I read a huge amount.
Anything recently that you would recommend?
Oh, let me think of it. Actually, I almost hate to admit it. Lucifer, the TV show.
Okay.
When it first came out, I didn't even bother to watch it, because I thought, like, the devil is helping detectives in L.A. That's got to be the dumbest piece of shit I've ever heard of.
Sounds like an anime.
I mean, you know, the quirky detective, I mean, genre has just been overdone to
right.
death.
Right.
Okay, so I completely missed it in its network run. Mm-hmm. But then, of course, it got picked up by Netflix in the fourth season. So about 2 weeks ago, I said, okay, I might as well watch the first episode just to find out how bad this show really is. And it's hilarious. I love it.
Very nice.
So I'm like two seasons into it now. And so I'll be like literally watching half an episode and then going and doing 5 minutes of subtitle transcription. And then my ADD will kick in and I'll go back and watch another 30 minutes of this stupid show.
Excellent.
But they actually did a really good job of setting up the rules of the show, you know?
Uh-huh.
how
you guys good world build, world building.
The world building is actually the rules of Lucifer, the rules of the devil, are actually very well done.
Okay.
So it's actually a pretty funny and amusing show. So if you want a show that you can just like veg out to, and it's amusing, then that's my recommendation. My current recommendation.
All right, well, that kind of takes us to the end here, unless you had anything else you wanted to say.
I think we covered all my points.
Yeah, cool. Well, thank you again, sir. We really appreciate you having you on, and we'll be sending you a link to this so you can see it, where it's available and all that stuff.
I hope it's audible.
Oh, yeah, it will be. It will be. We've tested this. If it's not audible, I will
worst
kill
case,
Bill.
Get me on Skype. We'll just do the whole thing on Skype.
Cool. I appreciate it. It should be good, but thank you again. We really appreciate it. Thank you so much.
それはやめる現代に誕生した暗黒の象徴である。心密かに忍び寄り、人の感性をわしづかむ。その定めからは誰も逃げられないのだ。 働き荒野、ひとりひた走るもの、まだ見ぬ世界あるか希望抱いて。 信じるものはただ光る情熱、熱く燃えたぎるぜ、誰にも止められない心の。 世界の何もかも